Talk Radio. Julia Hartley-Brewer at breakfast on Talk Radio.
Good morning to you. This is Talk Radio Breakfast with me, Julia Hartley-Brewer. Thank you very much indeed for your company. Mike Graham, of course, will be back at 10 o'clock. And, of course, since we're now back on YouTube, you get to watch him as well. You lucky, lucky things. I know that will make that makes your day. We are streaming the show live, of course, on YouTube, Facebook and Twitter after that. Please sojourn off at YouTube because I love a little bit of big tech censorship, don't you? Anyway, it is no small point down to you for actually backing us. I really, really appreciate all of you lovely people getting in touch and basically speaking out against the censorship and allowing us to still have a voice online to make sure that people get a proper, free and fair debate and all the facts when it comes to the biggest issues of the day. Well, here's someone who definitely is a big fan when it comes to freedom of speech, and that is Julian Assange. Now, he's got a bail hearing today where to decide whether or not he will get to walk free from prison. He has basically been either kept himself, he was in behind bars, kept in an embassy in Knightsbridge in London for Ecuadorian embassy for many, many years, and then held behind bars awaiting US extradition. But after finding out last week that a judge has actually ruled that he should not be allowed to be extradited because of mental health concerns and fear that he would commit suicide if he was kept behind bars in the United States, pending the US appeal to that judgment, we are now in a situation where Julian Assange could actually walk free. Sam Armstrong is Director of Communications at the Henry Jackson Society, anti-radicalisation organisation. Good morning to you, Sam.
Good morning, Julia.
Good morning. It's been a fascinating case. Actually, I say it was last week. It feels like a week ago. It was on Monday that Julian Assange, was told that he wouldn't face extradition. Let's just go through what's going to happen, though, because the US want to basically extradite him to face a huge number of charges for espionage and the like, for those WikiLeaks on what actually was really going on behind the scenes when it came to the Afghanistan and Iraq wars. The judge has ruled that he's at so high a risk of suicide that he cannot be extradited. But he's not yet been freed. And everything is going to depend on whether or not the US are likely to win their appeal, surely.
Well, that's right. The judge's ruling was a deeply unusual one. She considered whether the extradition request was valid and found that it was. She considered whether what Mr. Assange is accused of doing would be a crime in the UK, and it would. But then in the end, she decided, well, because he's at risk of suicide, we can't extradite him. This is quite an unusual ruling, it's fair to say. We don't normally give people a choice, even a choice in these extraordinary circumstances, as to whether they are or are not extradited. And if this ruling were to be upheld at a court of appeal level, it would have pretty major ramifications as to how we're going to handle these kind of issues in the future. So it's likely that, if I had to speculate, that he will be retaining custody pending the results of that appeal. The courts aren't going to want to have him doing a runner to the likes of Mexico that have already offered Mr. Assange a potential to emigrate there.
Yeah, I mean, that's the thing. Is that the chances of him breaching any bail conditions is really rather high, isn't it? And we could argue, really, after all that time in the Ecuadorian embassy and all this time in jail, that perhaps a few more days or weeks, it may not be such a big deal. But is it likely that the US would win their appeal in this circumstance?
Well, as I say, it's a very unusual ruling, and they won on almost every single point. Mr. Assange had put up more objections, I think, to an extradition hearing than almost any other case I can remember since perhaps the bad old days of the Abu Qatada, Abu Hamza cases. So it's going to come down to the very narrow question of suicide. And the US will, I'm sure, be prepared to make enormous undertakings in order to secure his extradition. About the kind of care that they will provide him in custody. I'm sure they will make offers about suicide watchers, about constant surveillance, about officers that never leave him. And if anything, I think there's a risk in Mr. Assange's strategy that almost he's He risks making his own conditions in the US worse if the US does do so. He might well be in a position in which the lights in his cell could never be turned off. He has to sleep in the lights, without blankets and all the rest of it for fear of suicide. So the courts, I think, are going to want to look very seriously at this ruling because, as I say, if the implication is that if you threaten to commit suicide and the court considers it serious, if you're extradited, you're going to have literally hundreds of deportation cases.
Well, I've got to be honest with you. If I was facing extradition, that's what I would claim as well. I mean, you'd be mad not to claim that. And I have to say, in terms of, I mean, let's face it, what Julian Assange is facing, 18 offences, one of computer misuse, but 17 counts of espionage, a total maximum prison sentence of 175 years, because America likes to roll out these ridiculous sentences, not just dying behind bars, but 175 years. The reality is, he would face horrific treatment in America anyway, the sort of levels of isolation, as you're talking about, you know, no blanket and in a cell that's 24 hours a daylight, and again, he would be in isolation. That, in any other circumstance, people would call that torture.
Well, America treats those who jeopardise its national security seriously. I don't think we can really hold it against them. The cost of terrorism, for which these sorts of prisons were instituted, was enormous to the United States. And indeed, the cost of Mr. Assange's actions were very serious. It jeopardized the lives of American agents, American soldiers overseas, and rightly, parties on both sides of the aisle in America have taken a very dim views to Mr. Assange.
Where do you stand on this? I don't think Julian Assange is a very nice person. I don't think he's a very trustworthy person. I think he acted very irresponsibly in terms of a lot of these the risk that he put service people and spies and others at risk, when we know that, you know, the people he was working with at The Guardian and elsewhere, they were actually trying to make sure that a lot of this stuff was redacted to make sure they got the overall leak out, but without putting people in any danger, which could have been done. He didn't do that. But should he face life behind bars in isolation for doing what is effectively, as he would claim, a journalist's job? Does he have a duty of care to those people?
Well, let's be clear, he's not being sentenced to prison for being a journalist or for publishing stuff. What he's being charged with, and it should be clear, he's gotten absolutely the right to a fair trial, and he's not been found guilty of anything yet, is hacking and obtaining information through illegal means. Now, Julia, you were a journalist for a number of years, and I can bet your bottom dollar that in the entire time that you were a journalist, you landed a great number of scoops and exclusives. You never felt the need to hack or to conspire with others to hack. You
never, I did not.
Used legal methods. And you obtained all your stories fairly. And in this country, when journalists have obtained their stories improperly through phone hacking and other means, they have gone to prison. The US is absolutely entitled, in my view, to apply the same or a similar standard. Okay. And that's what the judge found in this case.
All right, Sam, we'll have to leave it there. Sam Armstrong from the Henry Jackson Society. Really interesting conversation. Thank you very much indeed for joining me.